Father, we are grateful that we are yours and you are ours. We thank you, Father, that as we meet here together this morning, your Spirit indwells your people and your Spirit is here with us, leading us in worship. We desire that our worship be in spirit and in truth, that it be pleasing to you, that it be focused upon your Son, Father, and that your gospel might be made clear. We are grateful, Father, for this opportunity to gather together. We know, Father, that one day we are going to be with you in the new heavens and the new earth, and you will be with us. Your tabernacle, we're told, will be among men, and you will dwell with us, and we shall be your people, and you yourself will be among us. Father, what a wonderful promise that is. And Father, that is true in a sense even today, as you are here with us through your Spirit. And we pray, Father, that all would go according to your plans. You are a sovereign God, and we trust in you. May our worship, Father, be glorifying to you today. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Let's stand together and sing hymn 28, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Praise his name, I'm fixed upon it. Remain standing as the word of God is read. John.
This morning's scripture reading is 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verses 14 through 17. That's 2 Chronicles. Did I say first? 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verses 14 through 17. 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verses 14 through 17. I'll begin in verse 13 to pick up the context, the reading of the holy, inspired, inerrant word of God. So Solomon came to Jerusalem from the high place that was at Gibeon, from before the tabernacle of meeting, and reigned over Israel. And Solomon gathered chariots and horsemen. He had 1,400 chariots and 12,000 horsemen, whom he stationed in the chariot cities with the king in Jerusalem. Also the king made silver and gold as common in Jerusalem as stones, and he made cedars as abundant as the sycamores which are in the lowland. And Solomon had horses imported from Egypt and Kiva. The king's merchants brought them in Keva at the current price. They also acquired imported from Egypt a chariot for 600 shekels of silver and a horse for 150. Thus, through their agents, they exported them to all the kings of the Hittites and the kings of Syria. You may be seated. So we pick up our reading here. You may remember last week we saw Solomon. God appeared before him in Gibeah. And God said to Solomon, ask what you will. And Solomon had asked for wisdom. And this pleased God very much. And God said to Solomon, because you didn't ask for the necks of your enemies and for great riches and honor, I will give you those things in addition to the wisdom that you had asked for. And we see Solomon applying that wisdom here as he rules over Israel. And we see the prosperity that God has given him. God promised in verse 12 that I would give you riches, wealth, and honor, such as none of the kings have had who are before you, nor any after you shall have. So we see God faithful to his promise to Solomon and prospering him in such a way that gold is as common in Jerusalem as stones. I mean, can you imagine? He's doing very, very well as he's reigning for the Lord. And a couple points I want to bring up. First of all, we see God's faithfulness, just so true to his word. God can be trusted when he gives us these types of promises. Secondly, we see the wealth, the great wealth that Israel has. And when I look at this, Solomon was the son of David, as Christ was. And I think when we have this picture before us here in the Old Testament, it gives us just a shadow, just a taste of our Lord Jesus Christ as the King of Kings. In him, as the son of David, dwell all the riches of wisdom and honor. In Christ, we read of him reigning when he comes the last day and him reigning in the New Jerusalem, which is paved with gold and all kinds of precious stones and silver that we're reminded to in the book of Revelation. So we have that foretaste, if you will, of Christ in Solomon. And we can take, I guess, some pleasure in just hoping for the return of our Savior and trusting in him and being reminded that in him are the riches, wealth, and honor that we should be seeking on a daily basis, not the riches and wealth and honor of the world. But there is a warning in this passage, which, frankly, if I'm going to give you full disclosure, I went right over. But thankfully, God gives us commentators. And, I have a program that I have on my iPad. It's called Blue Letter Bible, if anyone ever has it. But if you go on there, John Lampy's laughing because he doesn't have an iPad. But do you have a cell phone yet? I'm not sure. But, that being said, you have at your fingertips commentaries, and there's, Matthew Henry, Jameson Fawcett Brown, and this gentleman, James Guzik, and I'm going to read to you what he wrote, because I think it's a warning to us, because we read in this passage that Solomon multiplied horses from Egypt, and that was actually forbidden in Deuteronomy 17, verse 16, which said, God was saying to future kings, but he shall not multiply horses to himself, nor cause the people to return to Egypt, to the end that he should multiply horses, for as much as the Lord hath said unto you, you shall henceforth return no more that way. So that was a warning given to kings about grabbing horses from Egypt. And David Guzik tells us that although Solomon, it appears from the passage, multiplied these horses and chariots from Egypt to, give prosperity to Israel, right? We can rationalize sin, can't we? We can rationalize disobedience to God. And it sounds good. Hey, right? We're making money for Israel. Hey, they're not for me. Or, we're selling these to the kings of Syria. But he goes through a progression here. So it starts with this disobedience of multiplying horses from Egypt. What does Solomon do next? Then he marries Pharaoh's daughter from Egypt. What does Solomon do after that? Well, then he starts marrying more foreign women. He starts multiplying wives. What happens after that? Well, husbands, if your wife asks for something, you don't want to say no, right? Well, these wives start asking him for a temple for their gods. He starts building temples, right? Idolatry starts multiplying. And finally, what does Solomon start doing? Well, now he starts going into these temples and starts worshiping these gods himself. So we see a progression of sin here, don't we? And it started off where he had a pretty good rationalization in the beginning and ended with this king, this great king, going down a path that would lead the whole nation astray and would lead to the split of the kingdoms. Right? So it's a warning to us, brothers and sisters. We have to take sin seriously. And we have to be vigilant in our lives, relentless in our lives, to deal with sin, because sin wants to destroy us, just as it destroyed Solomon. So we have a great picture of our Lord Jesus Christ, who forgives all sin, and we have a picture of our own hearts. Praise God, we have the gospel. Amen?
Amen.
So with that, I leave you, and Pastor will talk about the atonement, but we have forgiveness through Jesus Christ.
Father, we are so grateful that you are a God who forgives. Father, we can see some of Solomon in ourselves. We know what it is to rationalize sin. We know what it is to let sin take more and more and more of us until we find ourselves so deeply in bondage, Father, that we cry out to you once again for repentance, for renewal, for forgiveness. And you give it, Father. You are a God of grace. And when we come and confess our sin to you, you are faithful and just to forgive us. You are faithful and just to cleanse us, Father, from all of our sin and unrighteousness. Thank you. You have done that through Jesus. You have sent your Son, Father, to take the wrath that we deserve upon himself, that if we might trust in him, we would be saved. We would be forgiven. We would be reconciled to you. How grateful we are. Father, cause us to be sensitive to our sin. Cause us to be able to know when sin is spreading out its tentacles around us, seeking to drag us down into its grasp. Father, may we understand just how much you hate sin and how much you love us and desire us not to be bound by sin, but to be free in Christ, free to live lives of holiness and purity, lives that please you and honor you and bring you glory. We thank you, Father, for your word. As the psalmist says in Psalm 103, Father, we bless you. All that is within us, Father, desires to bless your holy name and to forget none of your benefits, because it is you who pardons all our iniquities. It is you who heals all our diseases. It is you who redeems our lives from the pit. It is you who crowns us with loving kindness and compassion. You satisfy our years with good things, so that our youth is renewed like the eagle. What blessed promises. Thank you, Father, for your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please turn with me to Psalm 76 as well. Psalm 76, another psalm of Asaph this morning. This is our God. God is known in Judah. His name is great in Israel. His tabernacle is in Salem. His dwelling place also is in Zion. There he broke the flaming arrows, the shield and the sword and the weapons of war. You are resplendent, more majestic than the mountains of prey. The stout-hearted were plundered. They sank into sleep, and none of the warriors could use his hands. At your rebuke, O God of Jacob, both rider and horse were cast into a dead sleep. You, even you, are to be feared. And who may stand in your presence when once you are angry? You caused judgment to be heard from heaven. The earth feared and was still when God arose to judgment to save all the humble of the earth. For the wrath of man shall praise you. With a remnant of wrath you will gird yourself. Make vows to the Lord your God and fulfill them. Let all who are around him bring gifts to him who is to be feared. He will cut off the spirit of princes. He is feared by the kings of the earth. Our gracious God and Father, you are the God that Asaph speaks of. You are the God who goes before your people into battle. You did it for Israel, Father, and you do it for us. Not in the same way, of course. We are involved in spiritual warfare. And in that kind of warfare, Father, you continue to go before your people. You give us the weapons that are necessary in order to fight that battle. You give us the armor as Paul describes it in Ephesians 6. You expect us to stand, Father, and resist the devil that he may flee from us. Father, we pray that you would make us a faithful people, a people who understand what's going on in the world is not just the normal course of events, not simply random events, not what some impersonal fate would bring about, but what's going on in the world, Father, is your act in your sovereignty to bring about your purposes. And even those things that we see in the world that are indeed evil, Father, they are a part of this warfare. May we not see only the material and the physical. May we understand there's something going on behind the scenes. And may, Father, we be faithful in engaging in that spiritual warfare, not giving up, not being passive, but claiming your power and your authority as we seek to be faithful witnesses of yours in this world that is so obviously opposed to you. May we be bold in standing forth on the truth of your word, Father. And may your Spirit work through the proclamation of your word to build your kingdom, to call your people to yourself. Do this, Father, for you are resplendent, more majestic than the mountains of prey. You are the God who sees from heaven. You are the God who knows everything about us, everything about what we are going through, and you have a purpose in it. We pray, Father, that these truths would be a comfort to those who are in trouble today, those who are ill. We think of Mary Grace this morning, Father. We thank you for the wonderful work that she has done with the Christian Academy. We thank you, Father, for her love for you and her love for those children, her desire to teach them of you. But, Father, she's going through a difficulty right now, and we pray that you would give her perspective on this, that she might look to you and know that you have a reason for it, that she might know as well, Father, that you are a God who can heal, and that she might trust in you. We pray, Father, for her family and for the school. We pray that you would, by your Spirit, give them peace. That this would be a situation, Father, which would bring revival. That they might seek your face. That they might fall on their knees. We pray, Father, you would do the same for us. Bring revival to our church. Cause us to love you, Father, with our whole hearts. Cause us to trust you in every situation. And cause us to proclaim your goodness and your glory to a lost and dying world. Father, do this because you are concerned for your own glory. Make that our concern as well. Father, give us a love for the gospel, even today. May we come to understand as we have never understood before what the gospel means in its completeness, what your grace means to us, that grace which has been showered upon us, though we don't deserve it, though we deserve your wrath, yet, Father, in your love and in your mercy, you have poured out your grace beyond measure. And you have saved us, and you continue to do so. May we love your gospel. May we love your grace. May we love your Son. Give us a hunger, Father, and a thirst for your word. May your Spirit move among us so that we cannot get enough of it, so that we desire to see ourselves in your word, so that we might confess our sin and rejoice in your mercy. May we open the pages of your word and see Christ everywhere and rejoice in him and come to love him more than we have ever loved him. May we not lose our first love, but hold on tight And may that love for Christ grow day by day. Father, make us people of prayer. Cause us to love, to fellowship with you in prayer. Make prayer for us a time of sweet communion and excitement. Cause us to always be aware that it is through the prayers of your people that you bring about your purposes in the world. We don't have to know how, Father, but we ought to know that this is how you work. You call upon us to pray, and you call upon us to pray according to your will, that will that is set out in the Scriptures. That will that tells us, Father, that your first priority is your own glory and that you will glorify yourself through calling a people from every tongue and tribe and nation for yourself. And that you will glorify yourself, Father, as Jesus returns. And this world is judged and your people are glorified. Father, we pray to those ends. Work your will. Accomplish your purposes. Father, we pray this in the name of Christ, our Redeemer, our Savior, the one who gave himself for us, the one who bled and died for us, the one whom you crushed for us. Amen. Please be seated.
Will the ushers please come forward? I'm going to read Romans 12, 10 through 13. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor, not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer, contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality. Father God, we thank you that you reign. We thank you that you brought us together in this place as the body of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you that you've done all things for us. And Lord, we thank you that you choose to use us to share your gospel and do your will. Lord, bless these gifts that we give. Lord, give us a heart that longs to give more. Lord, give us a heart that gives all of ourselves to those here and those around us. Lord, that we may be a light, that we may share your gospel, that we may love your word and love your people. Lord, may your Son bless this place. May your Spirit be within us and upon us. Bless these gifts and the ministries that come from this place. Lord, cause us and our ministries and those we contribute to bear fruit. Lord, and that we don't bear fruit, Lord, cut us off. Lord, may we be branches that bear fruit. May this place bring your gospel to this world. Make us eager to share, Lord. For the time is short, and we long for the coming of your Son, when he will reign in every aspect. Lord, we live in a world that is so torn apart, such a mess. Lord, we know that you reign, we know that you are sovereign, but we endure suffering and we see such hardship. Lord, give us a heart to reach out to those around us with the only thing that really matters and actually helps, your gospel of your great Son. Lord, bless these gifts and all those in us, all those here in this place. Lord, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you would, take your Bibles and turn to John chapter 2, where we will be looking at the first sign that Jesus did in his ministry. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 12 of the Gospel of John chapter 2. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does that have to do with us? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Whatever he says to you, do it." Now there were 6 stone water pots set there for the Jewish custom of purification, containing 20 or 30 gallons each. Jesus said to them, "Fill the water pots with water." So they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Draw some out now and take it to the head waiter." So they took it to him. When the head waiter tasted the water, which had become wine, and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the head waiter called the bridegroom and said to him, "Every man serves the good wine first, and when the people have drunk freely, then he serves the poorer wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." This beginning of his signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. After this, he went down to Capernaum, he and his mother and his brothers and his disciples, and they stayed there a few days. Our Father God, this is your word. Come to us through the inspired pen of John the Apostle. We come, Father, to a passage in which we find much rejoicing, but also some trouble, very much like the lives that we live. Teach us then, Father, from this text. Help us to see Jesus and to learn of him. For it is in his name that we pray. Amen. I have been privileged to participate in quite a few weddings over the years, both as a groomsman and a groom, of course, and as an officiating pastor. And in my experience, it is the rare occasion when something memorable does not occur. And by memorable, I mean something goes wrong. There was a time when there was a thin plastic runner set down in the center aisle for the bridesmaid and the bride and her father to walk down as they process to the front of the sanctuary. And under normal circumstances, this isn't a problem, but these particular bridesmaids had very sharp pointed heels, which penetrated the plastic as they walked down. And so during the procession, you have these bridesmaids tripping down the aisle as they come. Fortunately, no one actually fell, but they left behind them a shredded piece of plastic that the bride then had to navigate down as she came. Fortunately, she had her father to hold on to. I was in the bridal party of a good friend of mine who managed to make it through the ceremony just fine, but afterwards, as we were at the front of the church reenacting things for the photographer, I heard a thud and looked over, and there was no more groom. He was down there, having passed out. This caused his new wife, of course, to go into hysterics, and I did what any good friend would do, and immediately was encouraging the photographer to keep taking pictures. We don't want to miss this. When we were out in Colorado, one of the high school kids in our church was taking a class which for some reason included planning and participating in a mock wedding. And the kids did the whole thing. They rented tuxedos and gowns, and they reserved the church for the rehearsal and the ceremony, and they planned and held a reception. And one of the girls was the bride, one of the guys was the groom, one of the guys played the role of the father of the bride, and I was asked to come and lead them through this and mock officiate at this mock wedding. And so I show up and I lead them through the rehearsal, and the bride, I see, is going to be wearing this very long flowing gown, long train behind her. And so all through the rehearsal, I'm telling the kid who is going to be the father of the bride, listen, when you pick up her veil and go back to sit down in the pew, you need to make sure you turn away from the bride. Because if you turn in, you're going to get tangled up in her dress, and that's going to cause a problem. So I must have told him this 20 times throughout the rehearsal, and we get to the actual ceremony. Everything's going fine, and the young man escorts his bride to the front of the church and up the stairs onto a platform about this high. And then does exactly what I warned him not to do, of course. He turns, he gets tangled, he falls off the platform flat on his back, rips the dress to shreds in the process. And it was all videotaped. And that's pretty much what the reception consisted of. Everybody huddled around the TV, going, fast forwarding, and then reversing, rewinding. And this kid spent the whole time just up and down, up and down. Had to feel sorry for him. Some of you were at Sarah Fiore's wedding when we had the reenactment of Noah's flood. That was a memorable occasion. Well, we don't know whose wedding this was in John chapter 2, but it was one of those memorable occasions. Typically, a Hebrew wedding ceremony took place late in the evening following a feast. And after the ceremony, the bride and groom were taken to their home in a torchlight parade, complete with a canopy held over their heads. Now, you have to understand, this was after about 7 days of feasting. Hebrew weddings went for a very long time. As they were led to their new home, they were always taken along the most circuitous route possible so that everyone would have the opportunity to wish them well along the way. Instead of a honeymoon, they held an open house for this week, and they were considered to be the king and the queen, and actually wore crowns and dresses and dressed in bridal robes and so forth. Now, the problem, of course, that we will come to in this particular wedding is very serious. We might not understand the seriousness of this, but it was such a memorable problem, we're still talking about it 2,000 years later. that which went wrong is set out for us in verse 3. The wine ran out. They have no wine. And in a Jewish wedding feast, wine was essential. Not so that the guests could drink to excess, but because the wine was a symbol of great joy and celebration. It was of such great importance that if the wine ran out, that was considered grounds for a lawsuit against whoever was responsible. Those who were behind the scenes at this little wedding in Cana were shattered by this breakdown of hospitality. It was scandalous. Childhood dreams of the ideal wedding were about to dissolve in a nightmare. So the drama of this text is very real, though it is quite different from what we would experience in our own day. Let me try to place this passage in its historical and theological setting. Why does John even include this in the gospel? Verse 11 tells us, this was the beginning of the signs that Jesus did, taking place here in Cana of Galilee. When John uses the word sign, he always uses it with the idea of a miracle that is intended to convey deeper teaching. And that's certainly true here. We not only see Christ showing his glory in his power to change the physical elements from water into wine, but also in his power to change a life. That's why in verse 11 we see that he, through this sign and through the signs to come, manifested his glory. And we're also told his disciples believed in him. And we'll come back to that, but we see something going on here having to do with who Jesus is and how people respond to him. And this is what this passage is all about. This is why John includes it here. The positioning of this sign in the gospel obviously is of crucial importance because it's not merely intended to be the first of such miraculous events, but it also functions as the key to the signs of Jesus in general. When you come across Jesus' miracles, his signs, this is setting the tone. We understand that Jesus doesn't do miracles just to do miracles. Neither does he do miracles just to help somebody out, although he does, obviously. There is more to it. He is seeking to glorify himself, and he is seeking to change people's lives. That's the theological setting of the passage. That's why John includes it. John doesn't record everything that Jesus ever did. You understand that. He says that very thing later in the gospel. But he does include the wedding at Cana, and he does so because it's the first sign and the key to understanding subsequent signs. So that's the theological setting. Now, the first thing we're told about the historical setting of this sign is that it took place on the third day. Now, I need you to pay attention here because this gets a bit complicated. When John tells us that the sign occurred on the third day, what he means is that the sign occurred on the third day. You would be amazed at the fanciful explanations that are attached to that simple chronological statement that this wedding occurred on the third day. All kinds of symbolism and allegory are poured into those simple words. But the Gospel of John is not the book of Revelation. John's not writing in apocalyptic, allegorical, symbolic language. We're dealing with a straightforward account of certain events and teachings in Jesus' ministry. This is a historical narrative of something that actually occurred. Now, when we listen to Jesus teach, he will certainly use metaphors and similes and other literary devices, but it's clear that's not what's going on here. John is simply recounting a situation. He's giving a straightforward account of a wedding that Jesus and Mary attended, and it happened on the third day. I don't think there's anything to be seen here about the resurrection. It happened on the third day. Third day from what, though? Right? That's the natural question to ask. Well, just follow the text back to its previous context. The phrase third day refers back to the call of Philip and Nathanael in the previous passage. And if you trace this through the entire first chapter, you find a number of time indicators that tell us that the events from John the Baptist's discussion with the Jewish authorities to the wedding in Cana was about a week. That's what we're told is the third day. So on this third day, there was a wedding taking place in Cana of Galilee. A wedding was a major social event in the first century, and the celebration could last as long as a week, as we've discussed. Unlike modern weddings, which are traditionally paid for by the bride's family, the groom was responsible for the expenses of the wedding. And so this is why, when you come down to verse 9 and 10, the head waiter calls the bridegroom and talks to him about what has gone on. Now, this would be the culmination of the betrothal period. The betrothal period was kind of like an engagement, only more so. During the betrothal period, which could last several months, the couple was considered legally man and wife. And only a divorce could terminate that betrothal. You see this when you go back to Matthew chapter 1 and you see the account there in the Christmas story of Mary and Joseph. This is why in Matthew 1, Joseph is referred to as Mary's husband, even though they were only betrothed and there had not yet been a wedding. During this betrothal period, the couple was considered to be married, even though they did not yet live together and they did not yet consummate the marriage. On the night of the wedding ceremony, the groom and his friends would go to the bride's house. They'd escort her and her attendants to the groom's house where the ceremony and banquet would be held. And the whole celebration then ended with the actual wedding. Now, by attending a wedding and performing his first miracle there, Jesus is intended to tell us something. He is intending to tell us about the importance and the sacred nature of the institution of marriage, as well as the ceremony itself. Marriage is the sacred union of a man and a woman, whereby they become one in the sight of God. And the ceremony is an essential part of that, because it is in the ceremony that the couple publicly vow to remain together as long as they both shall live. Both the Old Testament and the New Testament view the public ceremony as a necessary part of marriage. Now, the public ceremony, a public declaration, can be done in all kinds of different ways, and there are all kinds of cultural differences that come into play. But the primary thing is that when a man and woman come together in marriage, everybody knows it. Everyone understands they have committed to each other for life. And that's certainly what is going on here. And Jesus is putting his imprimatur on biblical marriage as he attends the wedding at Cana. That Jesus attended this celebration reveals his ministry to be markedly different than the ministry of John the Baptist. John was what we might call a hermit, right? He lived off by himself in the wilderness. People came out to him where he was, and he preached to them, and he performed his baptism of repentance. Jesus' ministry was different. Instead of being a voice in the wilderness, Jesus moved among the people. Jesus was with them. He socialized with people and ministered to them in the context of their own lives and their own daily activities. That's what we see happening here. One last element of the general setting of the sign has to do with Mary. It seems fairly evident, though it's not stated directly, that whoever it was who was getting married was probably a close friend of the family. Because after all, as you read through this, it's not hard to tell who's in charge here. Right? Mary is the one who's running the show. And she's probably, you know, functioning as a close relative would, maybe an aunt or something like that. But she is the one in charge, and it's her responsibility to make sure that everything's running smoothly. Normally, this responsibility would fall to a close relative, and so we can probably make that assumption, though it's not clearly stated. But it's obvious Mary was more than just another guest. Mary wasn't just butting in where she had no business. Now, of course, the entire passage revolves around a problem that arose during the wedding. It's a problem which will lead to this wedding becoming so memorable that we're still talking about it. And that's set out for us, as we said, in verse 3. The wine ran out. In the Jewish wedding, wine was essential. It was not that the guests would all necessarily get drunk, but it was a symbol of joy and of celebration. So this is really important. This wine shortage was a serious breakdown in hospitality. Now, before we go any further, let me answer a question that some of you might be asking in your own minds. No, this was not grape juice. This is wine. Wine was a staple drink of the Near East. Due to the warm climate and due to the lack of refrigeration or pasteurization, it is an impossibility that what is called wine in Scripture could have been grape juice. We won't spend a lot of time on this, and we shouldn't have to. When the Bible says wine, it means wine. Right? There was a very short window of time in that day, just a few days after the harvest, when you could have had grape juice even if you wanted it. After that, grape juice starts turning, starts fermenting. It becomes wine, and there is no way to stop that. And so, although Scripture provides us with condemnations in regard to drunkenness, we do need to keep a balanced biblical view with regard to wine and alcohol. When there was a wedding, it was expected that there would be wine in abundance. The Scripture says wine is a sign of joy and blessing. And the absence of wine is a curse from God. It is a judgment from Him. It is called in the book of Psalms a gift that from God that makes glad the heart of man. And so a major crisis loomed at this wedding celebration when the wine ran out. This could have stigmatized that couple and their families for the rest of their lives. It could have left the groom and his family open to a lawsuit by the bride's family for failing to meet their responsibilities. You know, we're not the first litigious society in the history of the world. And so Jesus turning the water into wine was not just a sensational miracle designed to amaze with his power. Like all the rest of his miracles, this one was intended to meet the genuine needs of this family and their guests who otherwise faced a social catastrophe. In addition to that, as we're going to see, it was to raise Christ and to glorify him. Now, as we said earlier, Mary was apparently helping to oversee the catering of the celebration. And when she becomes aware of the problem that's developed, she immediately turns to the one who she knew could do something about it. And she says to Jesus, "They have no wine." And we don't know whether she expected a miracle to be performed, since as of yet, Jesus had not done any. We're told in verse 11, this is the first of his signs. So, you know, you can get all of that. What's his name with the Gnostic stuff and the Da Vinci Code, all that Dan Brown stuff. Get it out of your mind, right? He's coming from a perspective of early Gnosticism that has all of these stories about Jesus doing all these miracles as a child. And most of them he does in a fit of pique because someone did something he didn't like. All of that throw out the window. We're told here very clearly, this is the first miracle that Jesus ever did. So what Mary was expecting, we're not quite sure. But they knew, or she knew rather, that Jesus could take care of it. Jesus is her competent son. He could deal with situations like this. And we also have to remember, Mary knew better than anyone who Jesus was. She was well aware of his miraculous birth. And the amazing things said of him by the angel Gabriel and the shepherds and Simeon and Anna. And she had spent years with these things treasured up in her heart, we're told in Scripture, meditating upon them year after year after year. And she had witnessed the sinless life and perhaps had heard John the Baptist's recent testimony concerning Christ. Perhaps she was prompting Jesus to reveal himself publicly now as the Messiah she knew him to be. But when Jesus responds, we can only imagine Mary's reaction. Because to us, at least, Jesus' response sounds very abrupt, right? Almost rude. And we can break his response down into three parts. The first being the way in which he addresses Mary. Who calls their mother woman? Right? That just doesn't sound right. It doesn't sound very like a very nice way to talk to your mother. But Jesus wasn't being rude when he spoke to Mary this way. He was making it very clear that from this point on, there would be a major change in their relationship. Mary would not have been offended by Jesus' statement, but she would probably have been surprised. For Jesus to refer to Mary as woman was not a rude way of addressing his mother. It was polite, but it was not intimate. It was not a familiar form of address. This wasn't Jesus saying, mommy. But it certainly would have been different. The second part of Jesus' reply doesn't sound much better to our ears, and yet there is much more to it than we might think. What does that have to do with us? This is a Hebrew idiom, which essentially is a rhetorical way of asking what the two parties in question have in common. And it has the effect of putting distance between them. And so that statement, coupled with Jesus addressing Mary as woman instead of mother, was a polite but firm way of telling Mary that their relationship was no longer going to be what it was as he was growing up in her home. His public ministry was about to begin, and earthly relationships would not determine his actions. Jesus may have been Mary's son, but he would now be embarking upon the full fulfillment of his mission as the Messiah and Savior, as the Son of God. Now, the third part of Jesus' reply, this phrase, "my hour has not yet come," has puzzled some, particularly if one sees it as referring to Jesus' public ministry. Then we have a problem. If one sees it that way, then it would, of course, be very confusing, since Jesus ends up doing exactly what Mary wants him to do the next moment. That doesn't seem to make much sense. My hour has not yet come. Oh, here it is. No. What do we say then about this response? Jesus' statement is not referring to his public ministry, but rather this, his hour refers to Jesus' death and glorification. That's the way it's used throughout the Gospel of John, at least on 10 other occasions. And also it's used that way in Matthew and in Mark. It may be that Mary was asking Jesus to finally reveal himself. After all, she has been treasuring these things up in her heart for 30 years. I'm sure it would have been a relief to be able to talk to someone about it. But Jesus makes it clear that he would act only on God's timetable, not on hers. This timetable that he's embarking upon was decreed before the foundation of the world, and that's the one he would follow. It was not yet the time for Jesus to act in such a way that would advance the timetable toward his crucifixion. This is also why when Jesus performs healing miracles, he so often tells the people he heals not to say anything. Right? We don't want to rush things. Jesus' full messianic glory was to be revealed in its fullness at just the right time. And the miracle he would perform here at the wedding of Cana would indeed be a demonstration of his power. It would be a preview of the glory which would be revealed in him, but he would do it in such a way as to not rush the final outcome of his ministry. This miracle is often referred to as the first of as the beginning, rather, of Jesus' public ministry. But if you read the passage closely, you find that it really isn't all that public. His mother knows, and a few servants know, but that's it. The head waiter doesn't know. The bridegroom doesn't know. It's not really public at all. So though it was not his time to openly declare himself and to begin the countdown to his inevitable atoning sacrifice, that we will see happening in the temple next week, Jesus would nonetheless provide the solution for this problem, and he will save the day. And what's the solution? We see this in verses 5 through 10. His mother says to the servants, "Whatever he says to you, do it." Now there were 6 stone water pots set there for the Jewish custom of purification, containing 20 or 30 gallons each. And Jesus said to them, "Fill the water pots with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Draw some out now and take it to the head waiter." So they took it to him. And when the head waiter tasted the water, which had become wine, and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the head waiter called the bridegroom and said to him, "Every man serves the good wine first, and when the people have drunk freely, then he serves the poorer wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." Well, Jesus comes and solves the problem, and when he does it the right way. He doesn't produce mediocre wine. He produces wine of superior quality, and he produces a lot of it. The stone water pots were, as John explained for the benefit of his Gentile readers, used for Jewish purification rituals. Ceremonial washings were an integral part of first century Judaism. The Pharisees and all of the Jews would not eat unless they had carefully washed beforehand, observing the traditions of their elders. Jesus would later have some things to say about that. But when they would come to the marketplace, they wouldn't eat unless they cleansed themselves. And when they came to a feast, they wouldn't eat unless they cleansed themselves. And so you had these huge water pots to hold the water for the ritual purification. Now we're told that there were 6 of these pots, and each pot contained 20 or 30 gallons each. That's a lot of wine. That's up to 180 gallons of very fine wine. Now, much of that may have been given to the bride and groom as a wedding present. But the case remains, Jesus here made a lot of wine. Mary's faith and confidence in her son was not misplaced. As she had foreseen, he responded by commanding the servants to fill the water pots up to the brim. And they do so. They topped them off. And he creates this large amount of wine and rescues the bride and groom from this embarrassing situation. And when they are filled, he commands the servants to take some out, give it to the head waiter. So the head waiter is the wine tester. He's going to see if this is any good. He's the guy who comes to your table at dinner and gives you a little taste of it so you can test it before you, of course, say, "Oh yeah, that's really good, give me more." And he comes and he's amazed because this is better wine than they had before, and this is not usually the way it's done. Now, I myself can't tell good wine from bad. I have no clue. $5 wine tastes the same to me as $100 wine, and I couldn't tell you which is which, but apparently this head waiter could. Now, you need to imagine this scene. The head waiter tastes the wine which Jesus has created, and he's stunned. He can't understand what's going on. And so he calls over the bridegroom. And he says, "Every man serves the good wine first, and when the people have drunk freely, then he serves the proper wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." Now there's some historical evidence that most hosts did, as the head waiter suggested, serve the best wine first. In any case, it was only common sense to serve the good wine first and save the poorer wine for later when people had drunk freely. That verb, by the way, translated drunk freely, literally means to become drunk. It's the same word that you find in Ephesians chapter 5, when we're told not to be drunk with wine, but to be filled with the Holy Spirit. But we've got to be careful here with the head waiter's statement, because he doesn't say that this wedding ceremony had become some kind of drunken debauch. He's just saying this is the way it's usually done, and this is the reasoning behind it. And so, as we said, the head waiter calls over the bridegroom, and he marvels that the bridegroom actually saves the best wine for last. And the bridegroom didn't have a clue as to what the head waiter was talking about. And so you can just imagine, you know, the bridegroom saying, yeah, that's what we did. You know, they said, I don't know anything about wine, but this is a wine I would have liked to have tasted. This wine didn't come from the normal process of fermentation. This wine was literally from the Lord's vineyard. Well, the result of this first sign was twofold. What's the meaning of all of this? First, of course, we're told in verse 11 that Jesus manifested his glory. That is, he put his deity on display. Jesus' signs were not simply powerful displays of compassion, but they were designed to reveal who he was, little by little by little. But he's beginning now. And though the sign does reveal who Jesus is, there is a startling omission from this passage. There's not one word about anyone's response to this sign except for those who came with Jesus in the first place, his disciples. And we said before, there weren't a lot of people who witnessed this, but we might expect at least one of the servants would have said, "Wow, this guy must be the Messiah." But there's not one word of anything like that. And that should be a reminder to us that signs and miracles and wonders do not within themselves have the power to convince people concerning who Jesus is. It does not necessarily have the power within themselves to cause people to believe in Christ and to embrace the gospel. This is precisely the lesson that we learn in Luke 16 in the story of the rich man and Lazarus. There's rich man and there's Lazarus, the poor man, and Lazarus is eating crumbs at the rich man's table, and they both die, and the rich man goes into torment, and Lazarus goes into Abraham's bosom, and he's at peace there, and he's resting. And the rich man is in torment and cries out to Abraham, wanting him to send Lazarus to him to just put a few drops of water on his tongue to ease his suffering. And Abraham says, can't do it. Nobody can go from there to here or from here to there. And then he says, all right, well then send Lazarus back to my brothers so they won't come to this place. If they see someone risen from the dead, they'll believe. And Abraham says to him, you know what? They have Moses and the prophets. They need to listen to the scriptures. If they won't listen to the scriptures, they won't believe even if someone rises from the dead. It's not the miracles that do it. It's the power of the gospel. It's the power of the word proclaimed with the power of the Spirit. It is the sovereign grace of God that brings people to faith in Christ. Now, we are told here that his disciples believed in him, which is a strange thing, isn't it? Because haven't they already believed in him? We're always hearing about the disciples believing in Christ as if for the first time. They heard John the Baptist's testimony that Jesus was the Messiah. And in verse 34, we read that as a result, they believed. They heard Jesus' own words in verse 39 of chapter 1, and they believed. In verse 41. Now they see a miracle and they believe again. We're going to see this throughout the gospel. They believe, but they believe more and more and more as they come to understand who Jesus is. And so, you know, faith has degrees. It doesn't take a lot of faith for salvation, does it? The thief on the cross didn't know very much at all. He knew enough to believe. And that belief saved him. God saved him, but you know what I mean. How much do you need to believe? But after you believe, then you grow because you see who God is. You get to know him better. You commune with him. You see his power. You see his plans in the scripture. You begin to understand how you fit into them. And as we see God's faithfulness exhibited over and over and over and over, our faith multiplies. That's what we're seeing in the disciples. Yeah, they believed what John the Baptist said. Then they believed what Jesus said. Then they believed what Jesus did. And all along the way, their faith is deepening and deepening. And now they'll fall away and they'll run away and they'll have their ups and downs. But they're on a trajectory toward greater and greater faithfulness as they come to know Jesus more in a more real way. Many others reading this Gospel of John would come to believe, as the disciples did. And that was John's purpose in writing this gospel. Not only his account of this miracle, but the entire gospel. Remember what he says at the end of the gospel in chapter 20. Therefore, many other signs Jesus also performed in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these have been written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. We stand in a very privileged position. Here we are, 2,000 years later, and we know more about what happened at this wedding than most of the people who attended the wedding. God hasn't let us in on this for no reason at all. He has something he wants to accomplish. He wants us to understand either who Jesus is for the very first time and to believe and to place our trust in him, or he wants us to grow in that trust. He wants us to believe more and more and more who Jesus is and what he's doing. He wants us to rely on him. I trust that will be the work that he accomplishes in your life today. Father, we rejoice in Jesus. We rejoice, Father, that Jesus, the one who created wine from water, is able to bring life from death. He is able to make us new creatures, to give us life in him, and to cause us to stand before you as your adopted children. We're grateful, Father, for his power. As we continue to see what he has to say and to see what he does in the rest of this gospel, we are going to be confronted time and time again with the power of Christ. And that power extends far beyond changing water into wine. That is a power which changes hearts and lives. We pray, Father, that you would be about that business in the lives of your people, and we will give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together, hymn 69, All Glory to Jesus, Begotten of God.
of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Amen.